Okay, welcome everybody to the second talk of the day. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Henrique Bursztyn from the IMPA. And let me tell you a little bit about his mathematical career. He is originally from Rio de Janeiro, and this is this information is totally redundant for those of you who speak Portuguese. He got his bachelor's degree at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro in engineering, and then he got a master's degree in mathematics, and then he went to Berkeley to do his PhD under Professor Alan Weinstein in 2001. And his thesis was about Morita equivalence in deformation quantization. And he classified star products in Poisson manifolds up to Morita equivalence. After his PhD, he had several postdoc positions, most notably at the MSRI in Berkeley, and then in Toronto at the Fields Institute and the University of Toronto. And then he came back to Brazil in 2006. And he is now a researcher here at IMPA since then. His main mathematical interest is symplectic and Poisson geometry and related topics like Dirac structures, generalized complex structures, and Lie groupoids and algebraoids. He has written several interesting papers in this area, and he got a prize in 2008. He was given a prize, André Lichnerowitz Prize for Poisson geometry, together with Marius Krainich from Utrecht, right, Holland. Also, let me mention that he's the author of possibly the only book in symplectic geometry in Portuguese, an introduction to symplectic geometry, for a course that he gave at the School of Differential Geometry in 2006. So please welcome Professor Henrique Bursztyn, whose talk is titled Symplectic Geometry in Degree 2.
Thanks for the introduction. And so I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation. I'm also honored to be here and take part of this celebration. And so the talk, you see the title, is about symplectic geometry in degree two. So in fact, I'll say, I think, very little about symplectic geometry. And most of the talk will be, you know, trying to explain what degree two really means. So, so basically, rather than talking about theorems, I think most of the talk, basically the main goal is really to tell you about a viewpoint, you know, a different point of view to study geometrical structures related to Poisson geometry and to symplectic geometry. So if I were to summarize the talk with one diagram or one picture, you know, so basically it would be explaining the following, you know, principle, is that you can study unfamiliar geometry on a manifold M, which is a familiar space, I guess, or type of space. So there's a trade-off here, and you can instead, or equivalently, study familiar geometry on something that I will denote by a curly M, which is not a usual manifold anymore, but rather it's an object called graded manifold, which is, well, the type of graded manifold I'll be talking about is very close in spirit, not exactly the same, but very close in spirit, what physicists call super manifolds. Okay? So basically that's the idea. So, of course, you know, unfamiliar and familiar, you know, relative concepts. So, you know, familiar to me will be symplectic, and unfamiliar will be something that I will describe now. So, you know, I think that perhaps the first 20 minutes of the talk will be really motivating this kind of, describing this kind of unfamiliar geometrical structures. So, so here's a bit, you know, a more orthodox outline for the talk. So basically, I'll talk about Poisson structures and these related geometries that will be the unfamiliar part of this picture. And then I'll talk about N-manifolds and symplectic N-manifolds and, you know, describe a bit the unfamiliar spaces where the familiar geometry takes place. So let me start, you know, by just recalling the definition. So this already appeared yesterday in the lecture by Professor Katz, but, you know, in case you never saw the definition of a Poisson structure, there's nothing like it the second time. And so here's the definition. So this is basically, you know, an abstraction of what the kind of structure that Professor Katz spoke about yesterday in his lecture. So a Poisson bracket on a manifold, so M is just an ordinary smooth manifold, is just an operation that involves taking two functions and, you know, getting another function that satisfies certain axioms. So the first one is that this operation is Q-symmetric. The second one is that it satisfies a Jacobi identity. So, you know, the two first axioms together just say that this bracket is a Lie bracket on the space of functions on the manifold. And the third axiom is just a compatibility between the Lie bracket and the natural commutative algebra structure that you have on C infinity of M. You can multiply functions pointwise, so you have this kind of Leibniz rule. This is really an abstraction of a very familiar concept in mechanics. So this goes back to classical mechanics, and it was basically introduced to study, you know, the classical differential equations and the integrability of classical differential equations. In the 19th century, you know, mostly coming from celestial mechanics at the time. And there are two things that I would like to just point out about this object that I will use later. So I'll give a couple of examples. But, you know, the first observation is that, you know, I define this more, you know, more algebraically, but this has a more geometrical incarnation. So basically, you can, you know, there's always a certain tensor that describes the Poisson bracket by this formula, and this is due to the Leibniz rule. So it's what is called a bivector field, so it's just something dual to what a two form is. And the second observation is that, you know, one of the main properties of the Poisson bracket is that it allows you to turn functions into vector fields. And the way you do that is just to define this XF by this formula. So by the Leibniz rule, you know, bracketing with one function is a derivation, and this corresponds to taking Lie derivative with respect to a vector field, and, you know, this is the vector field associated with the function. So you call this the Hamiltonian vector field for this function here that you call the Hamiltonian, right? So in many physical systems, you know, you start with a distinguished function, and then this corresponding Hamiltonian vector field will govern the evolution of the system. So let me just give you a couple of examples just so that you have something concrete in mind. So the first example is fairly trivial. You know, it's like the totally degenerate case. You know, you can just take this bracket to be zero, and there's nothing much, not much you can say about it. But just to tell you that, you know, any manifold can be seen as a Poisson manifold in a rather trivial way. The second is just, you know, the non-degenerate case. Let's say like that. And that's what corresponds to symplectic geometry. And so here, basically, if you have a symplectic manifold, which is defined by a non-degenerate closed two-form, then the formula for the Poisson bracket is just this. So there's an associated Poisson bracket. And this Poisson bracket, you know, is very special in that in local coordinates, if you look at the matrix given by these functions here, this is invertible at all points. Okay, so it's a very particular case of a Poisson structure. And here, you know, the Hamiltonian vector field in symplectic geometry is defined by this equation here, using the two form. Okay, so on any symplectic manifold, you have a Poisson structure. And another example that is degenerate, but not in general, not as degenerate as this case here, but never non-degenerate as this one, is if you have a finite dimensional Lie algebra, then the dual space has naturally a Poisson structure. And the way to define it, basically, you know, you can see the elements of the Lie algebra as functions on the dual, just linear functions. And then for linear functions, you're going to have a bracket, which is just the Lie algebra bracket. And, you know, this basically defines a Poisson structure on functions, on all the functions here. Right? So there's basically an object that is dual to the Lie bracket. And finally, you know, and that's another motivation to go to Poisson structures, even if you are interested in symplectic geometry primarily, is the fact that if you have a symplectic manifold, and if you have a group of symmetries acting, basically a group, a Lie group acting, preserving the symplectic form, and if you look at the orbit space of this action, so in general, this will not be symplectic anymore. So there's no reason even for this to be even dimensional, right? I mean, for example, if you mod out by S1. But this space, there's always something reminiscent in this space that tells you that you came from a symplectic manifold, which is a Poisson structure. So this guy has a Poisson structure. So you can, you know, you can see Poisson geometry as a way to close the symplectic category, if you want, under quotients, right? So, I mean, you know, quotients take you out of the symplectic world, but, you know, if you are dealing with Poisson brackets, then you stay in the same category, okay? So that's one motivation. So I think that this abstraction was introduced by Lichnerovich, I think in the late 70s, if I'm not wrong. But, you know, it really started being systematically studied as, you know, a separate field of differential geometry, I think, in the early 80s. And several geometrical structures appeared in connection with Poisson geometry. So one is, you know, I won't define them, I'll just say some names. So one is the concept of a Lie algebroid, which is basically a way to, you know, extend this relationship between Lie algebras and linear Poisson structures to arbitrary Poisson manifolds, you know. So, you know, not every Poisson manifold arises in this way, but if you extend a little bit the notion of Lie algebra, then you can have a similar connection. And this places Poisson geometry, in fact, as part of some extended Lie theory, which has been very useful. So I told you that, you know, going from symplectic structures to Poisson structures, you can view it as a way to, you know, just work with the geometrical structure that is preserved under quotients. But there is another kind of operation in, for example, in mechanics that you may consider, which is passing to submanifolds. Right? You may have, you know, let's say a Poisson manifold, in particular a symplectic manifold, and a submanifold in here. So in general, a submanifold of a symplectic manifold is not symplectic again, right? And there's a whole theory in mechanics due to Dirac related to constraints that, you know, actually, you know, gives you ways to, you know, to understand these objects in their own right. But if you want to do that, you have, again, to go beyond symplectic geometry. And in fact, you have to go beyond Poisson geometry, you know? So these submanifolds will not inherit a Poisson bracket in general. And then that's, you know, one of the motivations for you to study Dirac structures. So it's one step further. So now you're kind of closing the symplectic, you know, category, so to say, under quotients and passing to submanifolds. So in defining Dirac structure, so this was done by Ted Courant, who is the grandson of the famous analyst Courant, who was a student in Berkeley in the 80s. So in doing that, in understanding these geometrical structures, you know, Courant and Weinstein were led to, you know, a kind of a new viewpoint to understand geometrical structures in general. And this was based on the concept of a Courant, what later was called a Courant algebra, that I'll, you know, I'll say a few words about this. And, you know, these objects turned out to be, you know, there's a class of these objects that is parameterized by closed three forms that turned out to be very useful, you know, in physics, where these three forms appear in, you know, under several incarnations. And then later in, around 2003, 2004, Nigel Hitchin, you know, building on all this machinery, you know, brought complex geometry and Riemannian geometry and Kähler geometry into this picture as well, again motivated by having some kind of, you know, unifying viewpoint to all these geometries, you know, again motivated by certain results in physics, you know, that relate complex and symplectic structures like mirror symmetry or T-duality. So it was rather convenient to have a general setup where you can view different geometrical structures in equal footing. That was the idea here. So and this had really like a very impressive impact in physics in the last 8 years, since 2004, more or less. So I just checked, you know, so there is one foundational paper, which was actually a thesis of a student of Hitchin that was written in 2004. And I checked just before coming here. And as of now, it has 650 citations, you know, in this Google Scholar. So I think for 8 years, it's not bad at all. You know, so a lot of people are interested in this business. So, you know, a central object in this whole story, in this whole viewpoint to geometrical structures is, you know, is this object called Courant algebraids. So I'll say a few more words about them. So basically, you know, Courant algebraids are the ambient where you can define geometrical structures. So usually you see geometrical structures are defined on manifolds, but it turns out that any manifold has a canonical Courant algebraid associated to it. And you can abstract that and do more general things. So let me tell you first what the canonical Courant algebraid associated with a manifold is, and then how to view various geometrical structures in terms of this Courant algebraid. Okay, so the Courant algebraid is defined as follows. So first of all, you consider the direct sum of the tangent and the cotangent bundles of the manifold. Okay, so in this bundle, you have several canonical structures that you can consider. So the first one is, you know, a pairing, a certain, you know, a symmetric pairing that's basically pairing vector fields and forms in a symmetric way. And this is a pairing that is not, it's symmetric, not degenerate, but it's not positive definite. So for example, TM itself is self-orthogonal with respect to this pairing, as it is T star M. So the other object natural here is that you can project everything that you do on T plus T star back to the manifold, to the tangent bundle. And there is a bracket on sections of T plus T star, therefore involving vector fields and one-forms, that is an extension of the Lie bracket of vector fields. But now it has an extra term here that, well, the way I've written it is not even skew symmetric. So, you know, it was an object that wasn't, you know, the meaning of this object wasn't very clear, but this was used by Courant in his work. And another interesting aspect of this object is that it has an extended group of symmetries. So you can view not only diffeomorphisms of the manifold as natural symmetries of this whole structure here by lifting diffeomorphisms in the natural way to T and T star, but also closed two forms naturally act here. And this kind of symmetries, it was not, you know, they were also known to physicists, and they were called B fields. So let me tell you now how you see geometrical structures in terms of this discrete algebra. So there are basically two ways, well, more, but you know, at least two ways in which you can do that. So the first way is by looking at, let me just draw a picture here. So the whole point now is that I'm considering Tm plus T star m, and what I want to explain is how you can view several known geometrical structures, you know, in terms of this bundle together with this bracket and the pairing that I defined before. So the first way you can put geometrical structure, define geometrical structures there, is by looking at sub-bundles of T plus T star, which are compatible with the brackets and the pairing. So the compatibility with the pairing is just that, is that this sub-bundle is self-orthogonal. So it's maximal, you know, with, you know, it has the maximal dimension with the property that this pairing is zero here. And, you know, there's also an integrability condition, which basically is an involutivity condition, just like you have for Frobenius theorem when you have distributions. But now you are on T plus T star, and you will use this new bracket. So examples of this object, for example, if you have a two-form, so you can view a two-form as a map from Tm to T star m, just by contraction, right? I mean, you have a two-form, you put in one vector, it spits out a one-form again. So if you look at the graph of a two-form, it satisfies this as long as the two-form is closed. So the integrability condition, this involutivity condition, amounts to the two-form being closed. If you are in the case of, for example, Poisson structures, now you have a map going the opposite direction from T star to Tm. And again, you can view it as a sub-bundle of T plus T star as its graph. And now the integrability condition really amounts to the Jacobi identity of the Poisson bracket, which is the integrability condition there. And another example, for example, would be if you consider, you know, usual distributions on the manifold, you can promote them to sub-bundles, self-orthogonal sub-bundles of T plus T star by adding to the distribution its annihilator. And then this integrability condition amounts to the involutivity of the distribution, which is the usual integrability for foliations. And so this is one way. So you can look at, you know, sub-bundles of T plus T star with, you know, certain properties, and you see that several, you know, different geometrical structures can be cast in that way. So another way, which was the way that I think Hitchin introduced, was to actually look at operators, just as you define almost complex or complex structures on manifolds. So usually you define a complex structure as an endomorphism of the tangent bundle that squares to minus the identity. So you can copy this definition now for T plus T star, and again, impose compatibility conditions related to these two additional structures. So the first one is that this endomorphism preserves the pairing, is orthogonal with respect to the pairing. And the second one is an integrability condition that basically you write out the Neuhaus tensor associated with this operator, but now we're using this bracket as if this was the Lie bracket of vector fields. And we impose that to be zero. And what happens is that this kind of geometry that was called generalized complex geometry by Hitchin and Gualtieri interpolates between symplectic and complex in a kind of interesting way. So if I write the endomorphism in matrix form with respect to the splitting T plus T star, you can view complex structures naturally as generalized complex like this. And you can view symplectic like this. So the diagonal terms correspond to complex geometry. The off-diagonal terms, you know, this anti-diagonal thing, corresponds to symplectic geometry. And in general, you know, if you were to write this object in most general form, this will be a Poisson structure, you know, whose degeneracy will tell you how far or close you are to one of the extreme cases. If this guy is completely degenerate, then you are in the complex situation. If it is non-degenerate, you are in the symplectic situation, but you can have intermediate things. Okay? So that's the idea. So I won't really get into it. It's all, you know, about, so it's, this is all about the unfamiliar geometry on M. So this is all unfamiliar. Okay. So just so that you have, I mean, I wouldn't expect you to really get all the axioms that I will describe now, but, you know, the role of this object, T plus T star with the pairing and this funny bracket that was not even skew symmetric, you know, it was recognized as pretty central in the definition, right, in this approach to geometrical structures. And this was axiomatized in a paper by Liu Weinstein and Xu in JDG in 97. So basically, you know, the key properties here are that you should have, you know, in order to you know, axiomatize this object, was that you should have a vector bundle, you know, some kind of pairing that I'm going to call an inner product, remembering that it's not positive definite in general. And, you know, a projection to TM plus a certain bracket on sections of E. So this all, you know, mimics the properties of this object that had appeared before, you know, satisfying a bunch of axioms, right? So these are the axioms. I won't go over them. But there are a bunch of compatibility conditions that were basically extracted from this, you know, from this model, from this example. And so, you know, if you just set M there to be a point, basically, this all boils down to a Lie algebra with an adding variant inner product pairing. But the other extreme case is TM, you know, T plus T star with this canonical structure. And or you can, in fact, add to this, you know, which became very important, you know, a closed three form. So there's a family of current structures on T plus T star, which is parameterized by closed three forms that gives rise to, you know, several interesting geometries, particularly if you are working on Lie groups where you can, you know, compact Lie groups. Often you have geometrical structures there that fail to be integrable by the Cartan three form that you have around. Right, and these kind of things also appear in physics, basically under the name of WZW for Vess, Zimino, Witten. So anyway, so as I said, so basically I could maybe specify a bit more this picture now. So I think that really what I want to describe is how you can understand this unfamiliar geometry that is also called generalized geometry, which is the geometry or courant geometry. So the geometry described in terms of courant algebraids, in terms of familiar geometry, and familiar to me is just symplectic. Right? So the point is that I can turn all these unfamiliar objects into familiar objects, but I pay a price, which is that I should work with something more general than just a manifold. So I just have a concrete motivation to do that. So why was I interested in understanding this? So I was interested at some point in understanding constructions using these generalized objects, you know, related to reduction. So reduction in symplectic geometry basically is the interplay between symmetries and, you know, and ways to construct smaller symplectic manifolds using symmetries. So basically what you do in differential equations a lot to solve differential equations. And so in symplectic geometry, I think I already hinted that, you know, using symmetries is not a it's not a completely trivial matter, because usually if you have I remember that if you have a symplectic manifold, and if you have a group of symmetries acting here, and you just look at the orbit space, so this in general takes you out of the symplectic world, right? This won't be symplectic anymore. So, you know, what is symplectic reduction, so to say, about? So it's really about finding, you know, nice submanifolds in here so that the orbit space, you know, which are G invariant or invariant by some part of G or something, you know, so that this orbit space will be symplectic. Okay, so, you know, what is usually not evident is like how to cut out the right submanifolds in this business. So often you use something called a moment map, you know, the level set of a moment map to get this guy. You know, you have conserved quantities, and they may tell you which submanifold to take. But, you know, but if you want to extend that to this unfamiliar geometry, then things become kind of much more complicated. You know, partly because, you know, symmetries now can be much more general. You have these two forms acting as symmetries and things like that. So I wrote a few papers with Cavalcanti and Gualtieri in this business, where, you know, we really studied this problem quite a bit, but and we came up with many examples and many constructions, but, you know, there was still, I think, some kind of guideline missing for what we did. So, and the guideline is really given by this dictionary, right? So what I'm trying to tell you is that, you know, if you want, for example, to study reduction, you know, like the interplay between symmetries and this unfamiliar geometries on a manifold, what you could do is go to, you know, go to the setup where you know how to do things, you know, which is symplectic geometry. At least many of us know how to handle symplectic structures and symmetries, you know. But, you know, okay, but you have to, you know, live with the fact that you have to work on these more general spaces. Right? So if you carry out symplectic geometry on this side, you can then translate everything back to this side and get some, you know, non-trivial constructions and results. So that's the idea. Okay, so let me explain a bit how that goes. So, you know, this is the beginning of this dictionary, right? I mean, so this really illustrates this dictionary, and that's the beginning. So the beginning of this dictionary is like this. So the central object, as I said, is this thing called a current algebraoid. So you don't really have to remember any axiom, you know. But you have this, all this stuff defined on the vector bundle over a manifold M, right? And here you're going to define geometrical structures by looking at, you know, special subbundles, or by looking at endomorphism preserving this stuff, you know, whatever way you choose. But the point is that, you know, I could somehow break this information into parts. So what this beginning of this of the dictionary is telling us is that, you know, a vector bundle with a pairing, you know, a pseudo-Euclidean, if you want to call it, vector bundle, which is something very simple, you know, is equivalent to, you know, a symplectic object, you know, which is a symplectic manifold of degree 2, right? So this may seem like just a very complicated way to express something very simple, you know, but, you know, but it doesn't really matter. So once you do that, then, you know, the trade-off comes, and you see that, you know, this complicated stuff that we had defined, you know, additionally to this pairing, namely, you know, this funny bracket and the anchor, you know, they just become a function, just an element, you know, just a function on this space that I haven't defined yet, satisfying one condition, which is just that the function bracket with itself is zero. Right? I mean, this condition is completely trivial if you are dealing with symplectic geometry because the bracket is skew symmetric. But once you are in the graded world, then, you know, a function bracket, a function being zero, is something very non-trivial. It's called a master equation in physics. It's one of the very important equations in physics. So this formalism that I will briefly describe now, you know, that I think is unfamiliar to most mathematicians, turns out to be very familiar to physicists. Right? As I said, it's related to the super manifolds, and you can find similar, you know, definitions to those that I'm going to describe. For example, well, you know, I mean, they go back, for example, to something in physics called the BRST method, in case you've heard of it before. And there's also a famous paper in mathematical physics. I don't know why they kind of like letters like this, but, you know, just say AKSZ for Alexandrov, Kontsevich, Schwartz, and Zaboronsky, I think, you know, where this formalism of graded manifolds was developed. Right, so let me then tell you, so now I think the talk will start. So I think I lost track of time. 15 minutes, all right, so I'll give you a 15-minute talk. So let me just tell you then what these graded manifolds are, all right? So, so graded manifolds, so I'm going to call them N manifolds, and N here stands for an integer. Right, so when n equals to 0, this will be just a usual manifold. And then, you know, n equals to 1 will be something else, n equals to 2 will be something else, and so on. So there will be a whole hierarchy of objects. So in degree 0, the way, you know, you can think of a manifold, right? I mean, so how do you think of a manifold? You can think of it as described by its smooth functions, right? I mean, basically, if you know what the smooth functions are, you kind of know what the smooth structure is, right? So that's the viewpoint of, I think, basically, you know, algebraic geometry or non-commutative geometry, that you should emphasize functions. And one way to define a smooth structure is by, you know, a sheaf of commutative algebras on a topological space that, and what makes this a manifold is the fact that locally it's just, you know, C infinity of an open set of RD. Right? That's what a smooth structure is. And so one thing that you can do now to generalize that in a reasonable way, is to take this definition of smooth structure, and now rather than having a commutative algebra, which is C infinity of M, you allow your algebra to be graded. Right? So being graded means that you really have a direct sum and the product is compatible with the grading like this, right? And, you know, my definition of a degree one manifold will be just a copy of this definition, except that now I'm going to allow this A to be a graded algebra. So a degree one manifold is a graded, you know, a sheaf of graded algebras. You know, forget about sheaf if you don't like sheaves, but, you know, it's basically, you know, a sheaf of graded algebras that locally, rather than just being C infinity of U, will be C infinity of an open set with some extra variables adjoined. Right? So, you know, I change a little bit the local structure of what I call the structure sheaf of the space. And these variables here that I joined, they have degree one in the degree one case. Okay, so basically now the local structure of this guy is, you know, well, basically, C infinity of some RD, and you put some, right? So that's what A is locally equivalent to, right? So if I erase this part, I just have a manifold, right? So this is degree one. So what is degree two? I guess you can guess. So degree two is the same definition. It's a sheaf of graded algebras where now locally, you know, the local form is not only C infinity of an open set of Rn, but I have two types of variables of degree 1 and 2. right? So following this rule here, you know, following the rule of graded multiplication, you know, for example, the variables of degree one anti-commute, and these guys commute among themselves, you know, the usual thing. So just to give you a very, very concrete example of, let's say, a degree one manifold. So in the end of the day, you know, like, you know, a degree one, let's say a degree one manifold, or degree whatever, n, degree r manifold, is just, you know, taking the usual, you know, smooth functions and adding more information to it, right? So basically what you have is, you know, now a new algebra that is graded, a sheaf of algebras over M, in such a way that the smooth functions sitting here as the degree zero part, right? But you have more stuff, you know, and this more stuff has meaning. So for example, one example in degree one, right? You can take A, for example, to be differential forms on M. Right, so this is a graded algebra. This is a sheaf of graded algebras in that for any open set, you can associate the differential forms on that open set. And locally, you can describe this guy as generated by functions and dx i's. Right, locally, this, you know, this guy trivializes like this. So, and these guys have degree one, so I'm in the degree one case. Okay, so let me briefly tell you, you know, how you can really unravel this definition that may seem complicated into very concrete geometrical objects, right? So I think that the main observation here is that if you take functions of degree whatever, j, and you multiply them by a function of degree zero, this again has degree j by this rule. So this is saying that the degree j functions are a module over the degree zero functions, but this is only C infinity of m, right? And this local property is basically, you know, going to tell me that, depending on the degree that I have here, that this guy is locally free. So all these guys here are vector bundles, okay? So let me go on with that, right? And the other observation is that, you know, you can do differential calculus on these objects, you know, M, rather than only have C infinity of M, this enhancement of C infinity of M, you can do calculus, right? You can talk about vector fields, which are just derivations of this, just like you do in algebraic geometry or non-commutative geometry. You can talk about submanifolds, which are given by ideals. You can prove the inverse function theorem, the implicit function theorem. You can go over your favorite differential calculus book, Calculus of Manifolds, and you can reprove all the theorems in this setup. Frobenius theorem, distributions and Frobenius theorem, whatever. Okay? So the first observation is that in degree one, the only thing you really have to know, because in degree one, your algebra is locally generated by degree one functions. So the only thing you have to know is A1, what A1 is. And A1 is a vector bundle, and that's all you have to know. So in degree one, you know, a degree one manifold is nothing but a vector bundle. That's it. Okay? Now, and the correspondence is as follows, right? I mean, like A1 is the sections of the vector bundle, and then A is just the exterior algebra of this vector bundle. So in degree two now, you have to know what the degree one functions are and what the degree two functions are, because they locally generate everything. That's the local property, right? So what you need to know is really two vector bundles, and there is a certain additional relation. Basically, that tells you that if you multiply two things of degree one, you get something of degree two. So this accounts for this map here. But you see, like, I'm dualizing everything. So this map would go from wedge to E star to F star. So it's just a convention. So it doesn't really matter. Right? So, you know, as I said, you know, vector fields are, you know, derivations, degree one derivations, you know, so a degree one vector field that, you know, commutes with itself, right? Now in the graded sense, you know, taking the commutator in the graded sense, you know, if you take, for example, in degree one, this guy to be a vector space rather than a vector bundle, this is just a differential on the wedge of the dual, and this structure here is just a Lie algebra. This is the Shiba-Lie-Eilenberg differential for a Lie algebra. For example, you know, you can see several known objects in this language. So what is a symplectic structure now? Okay, so let me assume that you kind of got an idea of what these objects are. So this is like, you know, what the manifold, so to say, is now, right? So what is a symplectic structure? So the easiest thing for me now would be to define a symplectic structure in terms of its Poisson bracket, just because Poisson brackets are defined in terms of functions. And I'm just replacing functions by this algebra here, right? So, you know, a symplectic structure will be a Poisson bracket that I force to be non-degenerate. So there's an additional condition, and I would have to make sense of what non-degenerate means, but, you know, it's not hard to do that. And I can talk about now Hamiltonian vector fields just as before, and following this work of Chevera, Wurttemberg, Weintraub, and many more people, you know, you can go back to the dictionary and try to figure out what the existence of a symplectic structure on this extended sense imposes on the possibilities for these algebras here in degrees 1 and 2, let's say. So all right, so now, you know, this degree 1 or 2 symplectic manifolds are just a usual manifold. This, you know, this sheaf of algebras that is an enhancement of C infinity of M with additional variables and a bracket, and a Poisson bracket respecting the signs and the degrees on this algebra here. So notice that if you look at the, you know, the bracket relations, you know, it turns out that the non-degeneracy of the form forces the Poisson bracket to be of a certain degree. So in the case of degree one, it lowers degree by one. So you have these bracket relations here. You know, 0, 0 goes to minus 1, there's nothing minus 1, 1, 0 goes to, you know, so this is C infinity of M, this is C infinity of M, and here you have a bracket relation also on A1. So if you really see what this bracket relation gives you, so what this bracket relation gives you is really just an identification. So basically, what you have is this, that A1, the bracket with A1, gives me a map from C infinity of M to C infinity of M. This is just A0. And with the properties of the Poisson bracket, you can see that this map is a derivation. So what you really get here, and remember that A1 is sections of some vector bundle, right? So what you really get here is that A1, using the non-degeneracy, is that A1 is just vector fields on the manifold, right? Because this, you know, it acts by derivation, but this is really faithful by the non-degeneracy. And A is nothing but the algebra of multi-vector fields. So that's based, you know, which has a canonical bracket that extends the Lie bracket, called the Skelton bracket. And that's the only, pretty much, type of degree one symplectic manifold that you can have. So, do we still have 5 minutes? Okay, so that's the upshot. So basically, you know, in degree one, once you put a symplectic structure, you know, before you could have any vector bundle as a degree one manifold, once you put a symplectic structure, this vector bundle can only be of one type. You know, if you move on and you play the same game, you know, just playing with these bracket relations, you know, what you find out is that, so now you would have to know what A1 is, which corresponds to a vector bundle, and A2, which corresponds to another vector bundle. So, but if you play with the bracket relations, you know, it's not hard to see that the A2, in fact, you know, is the vector bundle that, you know, whose sections, if you want, gives the Lie algebra of symmetries of A1. So the upshot of this, I won't really have time to explain, but it's not easy to see, is that, you know, it has a name. It's called the Atiyah algebraoid of A1. But, you know, really what this, story here gives you is that if you look at the bracket for the degree one functions, this is now symmetric because of the bracket relations, like the signs. So this is symmetric. So this gives you a metric, a pairing on the sections of the first vector bundle, right? That's this part. And then these other relations will just tell you, basically, that the second vector bundle can be canonically described in terms of the first as symmetries. So you don't really have to care about the second vector bundle. That's all I'm trying to say, right? So in the end of the day, the theorem that you get is that, you know, a symplectic, a degree two symplectic manifold is the same thing as a vector bundle and a symmetric pairing on it, as I had mentioned before, right? So now, you know, now the story becomes more interesting, that you can choose, you know, a Hamiltonian function on this. So first I put a symplectic structure, and now I'm going to choose a Hamiltonian, which is just a function, you know, an element, a section of this sheaf here. And once you do that, you know, a Hamiltonian that satisfies this integrability condition, once you do that, you know, in degree one, this Hamiltonian, you know, if you take this of degree r plus 1, where r is the degree of the manifold, so in the degree 1 case, this would be telling you that I'm taking now something that is a bivector field, and this integrability condition is just the integrability condition saying that this bivector field is Poisson, right? So a Poisson structure now arises as a Hamiltonian on this other extended, whatever, space, graded space. And the magic thing that happens is that in degree two, that you know that the symplectic, you know, a symplectic degree two manifold is just given by a vector bundle with this pairing. You know, if you do exactly the same thing, if you take now a degree three function that brackets with itself to be zero, what you get is a courant structure, as I described before. So all these axioms from before, they now become only one equation, one integrability equation. Right? So the upshot is that this dictionary provides a hierarchy in which now you have symplectic and manifolds. So, you know, the hierarchy goes by the degree of the manifold, and you equip this manifold with an additional Hamiltonian that is integrable. And what you get is that in degree zero, you have ordinary symplectic manifolds. In degree one, you have Poisson manifolds. And in degree two, you have these courant algebraids. And you could go on and look at higher stuff. You know, but the moral is that, you know, there is a certain hierarchy of objects. So let me just jump ahead to the last slide. I won't have time to talk about, you know, any of the theorems really. But, you know, so this was just the beginning of this dictionary in which you translate this first unfamiliar structure into something very familiar, which is just a function on a symplectic manifold. So the next step, for example, could be, you know, I mean, if you want to do reduction, you know, you could ask yourself, you know, a nice class of submanifolds in symplectic geometry to do reduction are called coisotropic. So you could ask, you know, what is a coisotropic submanifold here, you know, and what does this translate to over here in classical terms, right? I mean, that's the geometric input if you want to do reduction. So this is something that I've been studying with Catania, Meta, and Zambon. And let me just tell you very briefly, for example, the type of stuff that you get. You know, if you just look at the definition of a coisotropic submanifold, then now in degree two, you know, what you get, you know, is something that, for example, you have naturally a submanifold, you know, a vector subbundle of this E, an integrable distribution of this submanifold, and, you know, a flat partial connection along this distribution that preserves the metric of this bundle. You get all kinds of classical geometrical structures, you know, just by following this dictionary. So the point here is that, you know, perhaps if you wanted to do reduction of these unfamiliar geometries, you know, you, perhaps you wouldn't even know where to start. You know, what's the geometric input that I need to carry that out? But once you play with this dictionary, you see like all kinds of classical things popping out. And you see that this is exactly what you need to construct quotients. You know, but this is just given to you by the dictionary if you do ordinary symplectic geometry on unfamiliar spaces. So let me just go over. So you know, this is like, you know, a bit of a more complete dictionary, but still this is just the very beginning, right? I mean, you could now add in, you know, group actions, moment maps, and all the usual things we do in symplectic geometry. But now groups would be groups also in the category of degree two manifolds, and actions would be in the category of degree two manifolds. But with this dictionary, you can get all these things and translate them back into classical geometry. And then lots of interesting things pop up. So I'll just stop here. Thanks.
Are there any questions?
So when you take a quotient for the symplectic manifold, you arrive to something like a grade, in some sense, to something like a graded manifold, right?
Right.
Of degree one.
Right, yeah.
Just one, yeah. But
yeah.
Continue this process, you can get to n, or
always
will be on one? You know?
Yeah, yeah. Taking quotients, you kind of stabilize there, because if you take a quotient of a Poisson, you get a Poisson again, unless you do.
So to get to two, you should do something different. Yeah?
Right, yeah. Mm. At least if you take a usual quotient.
Rika, I try to make contact with the standard supermanifold.
Right.
Just an example. So if you have a differential form on a supermanifold, you have two type of object, the ordinary differential and the Grassmann differential. Right. Do they correspond to, in this case, to the object of grade one and two in your approach, or?
Well, I don't think so. So the supermanifolds, they are really, they are related, but they are kind of different. So, so first of all, you know, in supermanifolds, the grading is Z2, right? So you only care about odd and even variables. And here I have you know, something that is refined. You know, I really care about the, you know, I have a grading. I have an N, if you want, grading in this business. And you know, There is a relation between these things, but you know, things here, in some sense, you know, they're often easier, you know, just because. So, for example, here, right? I mean, if you take two odd variables and you multiply them, you get something even, that is not on the body, right?
Yep.
And here, I cannot do that, right? If I take two variables on the body, they have degree zero, and if I multiply them, they still have degree zero. So I don't have, you know, I mix less the variables. I don't mix so much the. So it's really a different thing. So it's not so clear how to relate this to this. Mm-hmm. You know, in some places, for example, this AKSZ paper, they actually define these graded manifolds as a supermanifold with an underlying grading. But really, what I'm doing here is even forgetting about any possible underlying supermanifold structure. Things just are easier, I mean, at least for what I want. So I don't really know how to relate immediately the two things, as you were saying.
Okay.
You know, it's really like in the same spirit, but, you know, but it's not really the same.
Okay. One last question.
Can you formulate a couple of problems in your line of research? Open problems, I mean.
Well, I mean, there was one problem that one could solve, like a concrete problem that one could solve with all this machinery, let's say.
Yeah.
So, you know, so this unfamiliar geometry encodes familiar things. So, for example, you know, certain bi-Hermitian, structures are encoded in simple ways by these generalized things. And there was a problem, I think, posed by Paul Goduchon about the existence of these bi-Hermitian structures on certain complex surfaces. For example, CP2, I mean, he didn't know if these bi-Hermitian structures existed there or not. And one idea was, okay, now that we know that these bi-Hermitian structures can be seen as examples of these generalized and familiar things, you could try, and if you're interested in CP2, you could try to, you know, construct something on CP2 by reducing something on C3, something like that. And then, you know, and then if you know how to reduce, if you have a procedure to reduce these unfamiliar geometries, you know, from here to here, and if you know that these unfamiliar geometries, they include, you know, for example, these bi-Hermitian structures that differential geometers were interested in, you could potentially, you know, construct what they wanted here. And this was one of the motivations and applications in the very beginning of this story, right? I mean, certainly, you know, I could tell you all the story without mentioning any graded geometry or super manifolds or anything. But, you know, the focus here was more like to just advertise a point of view that, you know, leads to the solution of concrete problems. But I chose not to talk about concrete problems.
Okay, thank you. Our time is over. Before we thank our speaker, I wanted to give you an announcement. There will be a picture taken at the end of the section today at 3:50 in the afternoon, the last floor of the building. So please don't go away before everybody takes a picture upstairs. So we can now thank the speaker. Thank you very much.